Good morning. Wow, it's good to see everybody here. That sun is shining, and you know, I'd like a little bit more warmth, but I guess that snow's melting slow enough to keep some of the floods at bay, so we're kind of glad for that. I just want to take a moment and invite those that have community moments. I see we've got a couple people lined up here. Let's turn on a microphone and see what we've got to learn.
Good morning. It's a beautiful morning. Can I ask you to raise your hand if you have ever participated in our prayer vigil on Good Friday? Okay. There are only about 36 spots left. It's a special time to be in God's sanctuary by yourself with Him in prayer. So if you can find time between noon on Good Friday and noon on Saturday, the sign-up sheet is on the bulletin board. Come in and spend a half hour or an hour, because a half hour goes very fast. But it's just a good opportunity, as His disciples waited for Him, for us to be waiting for our Lord.
Great. Thank you. I appreciate it. Announcements along with that, just to get us into the swing here. You've seen the sign out front, I'm sure, reminding us of the two services on Easter morning. The first service is a little earlier than our normal. Instead of 9:30, it's at 9 o'clock. So keep that in mind. If you come at 9:30, the service will seem really short that day. And then we'll have an 11 o'clock service, and we've got different things happening at each of the services, so you may find that you'd like to attend more than one. We have an earlier service at 7 o'clock that morning, which will be a sunrise. It begins out in the courtyard out here in the garden, and we'll end up here. It's a short service, but it's a meaningful moment to kind of get our day going, when, as you recall, our Christ candle, which is lit now, will be extinguished on when? Good Friday, that's right, to symbolize the death of Jesus. We relight it out with a special kind of way we do that outside, with a little, the first fire of Easter. We'll relight the Christ candle and proceed with it in here and put it back on the table, all lit and ready to go for Easter morning. So 7 o'clock, then breakfast, 9 o'clock, and 11 o'clock. And prior to that, of course, we have the services on Good Friday, noon here in this room, 7 o'clock over at the Lutheran Church. So, and again, very different activities at each of those services. We'll do a Stations of the Cross early in the day at noontime, and we'll do some type of musical event, cantata-like, in the evening. So both should help us to kind of gain the context of the week. So be looking towards that. Mark.
Good morning. A quick reminder, on behalf of Kim Wood, we have a blood drive here this Tuesday, and as most of you probably know, the winter and the hard winter really affected the amount of people that were coming in and donating, so they are at a low, low point. So if you can find it in your heart and in your arm to come here maybe Tuesday and donate some blood, that would be a wonderful thing. Second, is anybody out there like really, really tender, juicy prime rib?
Ooh.
Yeah, yep. Okay. We are doing an ASP fundraiser on Saturday, April 26th here at the church. Myself and the senior high J team will be doing the cooking. This will be new this year. They're going to be helping me. So hopefully they can cut straight when they're cutting the steaks off. We will have tickets available next Sunday after church. So that's when we're going to open up ticket sales, and we'll have a table with some of our youth out here selling. And last but not least, as a reminder again, Saturday, May 10th is our auction. For those of you that didn't get the email or the e-blast this week, out on the coffee table are some forms that will remind you of the times. And also, if you find it in your heart to have a donation to give us, please take one of these forms and fill it out and get it back to me if you would. And as a small warm-up for that, we have something to auction off this morning.
Ooh.
A fresh Wesco Long John.
Ooh.
Well, we're starting the bidding at $10. $10, do I hear 15? Is there anybody out there willing to spend 15 for a fresh Wesco? How about 12? Does 12 work for anybody?
Oh, there's one in the back.
We've got 12 in the back. How about 13? Diane, how about 13?
No?
Oh, Linda, you've made her angry. I have 13. Does anybody have 14? I have 13. 13 going. That's already yours for 13. But if you want to pay more, we're happy for that. 13 going once. Wait, we got 15 in the back. Do we have 16? Do we have 16? You guys need to start doing these calisthenics. We have 15 looking for 16. 15 looking for 16. We have 15 going once. 15 going twice. Sold to Doug Wood for the first sale for our auction for this year.
Yay.
And Doug, I want you to know something special about our auction. We have a lot of new stuff, and we have a lot of used stuff.
But all right. I think that was about a $3 piece. What do you all think? Oh, my goodness. I'll tell you what. I come to this church, and there's new things I'm learning every week. All right. We have, as you all know, someone in our congregation. Sunday mornings, we try to give a little respite. And so this morning, again, I'll pass this. We like to work in teams of two. And in fact, we need to work in at least two in a team. So if you would sign up, perhaps somebody else, you can either recruit them or they can sign up along with you or sign up after you've signed up. But look to create teams of two. That's really helpful to us. Another sheet that is our sign-up, and note that there are only two clipboards, one for each of these, so when it gets to the back, pass it along and it can do the other side. This is for signing up to help us in the office as Wendy takes some leave coming up when the baby is here. So sign up and help us in the office, and we'll give you instructions if you will put your name there. Any other announcements? Yes. Carol's got an announcement.
Well, this has been on my heart for a while, and food pantry and clothing pantry, different ones of us help with that, and that is filling a great need. But really and truly, if you went to the food pantry, they don't have near the amounts to give out that they have had earlier. Their funds are strapped. And so it would really be nice if some of you would offer and bring in some canned goods or things that are normally eaten, like peanut butter and jelly and cereals and... just a lot, and you know, a lot of things, I pick them up when they're on sale at the store, and then we just donate them, but they really could use it. So if you would like to do that every so often, that would really be helpful. Okay?
Great, thanks, Joe. Anything else? Great, let's take a moment, let's greet our friends and neighbors, and I'll call you back together in a minute. Hi, how are you?
I know, I gave away.
You're what?
I gave away your pies, I'll make you one.
Oh, no, Gail brought one home. Wasn't given away. It was great. I'm glad you baked it. For the longest time, I forgot it was there. And then I saw it when I was doing some other stuff.
I got to make you rhubarb one.
Oh, yeah. That's good to see you, Tom. Rob speaks so highly of the barbershop group.
Oh, he's told you about that.
Oh, he has. He's really enjoying that. That's so good for him and for others.
Good, I'm glad to hear that.
Oh yeah, he's having a great time. Please remain standing and turn with me to the call to worship. When all we have hoped for and trusted in life has let us down, when the world seems dark and despair threatens to close in upon us, come and let us worship the Lord who is always reaching out to us in grace. Amen.
Thank you. come into your presence, O Lord, with so many burdens and concerns in our hearts. Help us to be open to your words of healing and restoration. Bring us closer to you. Enable us to discern your will for us, that we may serve you more faithfully by serving others in need. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Be seated, please. And I'd like to invite my young friends forward.
Thank you. Boy, can you tell that it's spring break? My goodness sake. And we have a girl's side and a boy's side. And whoa, let's see what we've got going today. Oh my goodness. I'm going to have to ask about these because they're so beautiful. There are two items and they must have special significance. And I'm going to guess maybe kind of what that is. But do you want to tell us? Are they Christmas tree ornaments? Is that what they are? All right, but they're significant both to you, I take it. And this is the Christmas tree ornament, which is a ballerina dancer, just really beautiful, with a little dress on and some wonderful little feathers to kind of make it highlighted, and just, oh, a tiara that she's wearing, and this violin. And so you put these both in here, and so this is important to you too, because of your playing? Yeah. So two important things, and your dancing this might symbolize, right? You know, as I see these, and I think we could all probably find something that is something we do that we could put in the box, all of us. I hope that there are two or three or four things that we have a passion for that we could find a symbol of and place in a box like this that might represent something important to us. You know, we've all been created in such unique ways, and we've grown up in such unique settings with parents that love us and encourage our gifts and the things we do well to flourish and grow, and to encourage things sometimes that we don't even do well, but things that we can do well if we practice really hard and we study and we learn. You know, something, something that we could learn to do. And now dance, on the other hand, I'd be hard-pressed to ever learn to do it. But you know what? It probably is something that even if a person would be hard-pressed, there might be some value. So what is beautiful about this is that not only are these things you're learning and growing in, but I have a feeling these are things you really love in life. Is that right? They bring you joy? Yeah. Joy is so important. We could spend all our time in the drudgery of doing and doing and doing things in life, finding no joy and finding no passions for what this life can be all about. And it brings me joy to know that you found these things. And I sense that these are only the beginning of many other wonderful joys that you will discover through your life. So thanks for sharing them with us. That is really great. One of the things I really enjoy about this box is that I have an opportunity, and in fact we all do, to learn about the young people of our church, some of the things that they do. I did not know about the dance, so that's really great. So I've learned something special about you today, and that's wonderful. Let's say a prayer together. Lord, there are so many distractions in life, and there are so many responsibilities and so many of the things that we feel we just have to do. It's so important that we find things that we really want to do and that we get to do. And Lord, help us to find how those things intersect with what it is that you have for us. Help us to discover how we can bring the talents and the gifts and graces that we have and offer them in some way to you. We will sense that yet today as we hear the violin played. We'll be reminded of a passion and something that we can give to God. Lord, all these things we hold up to you. We pray this in the name of your Son, the one who taught us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, I'm going to give these to you, and I'm going to keep the box. Okay? Today I'm keeping the box because I'm told next week I'm supposed to bring something in it. So we'll see how that goes, okay? That was what got her a number one at Solon Ensemble. Wasn't that great? I sure get that. We have such talent in this congregation. It is just so great, so great. Well, it's a time for us to pray, and wow, you've kind of given us our first prayer. You know, that's great. Who else are we praying for today? Who else are we thinking about today? I know you're all thinking about Sharon Myers, and we've been praying for her so constantly, and I've shared that with her as I see her about every other day. I saw her last Friday late afternoon, and they were about ready to remove the breathing apparatus so she would not be on a ventilator any longer, which, you know, it's prevented her from talking. And she's had several good days in relative terms. She's been sitting up with some strength and capacity to breathe on her own. She's had times when the breathing gets a little rough, so when I see her next, I'm just looking forward to having just a regular conversation with her. And so strength slowly is returning. There are still some things that are tough and challenging. She's still on dialysis, which is not easy at all. It's very, very tiring. Wears the person out. So keep her in your prayers, and we'll see as day goes by day how it's going. Who else are we thinking about? Yes. That's right. You know, it's hard to push people when they're recovering, but we've learned from the physical therapy these days, which is terribly challenging, how much of a benefit it can be and get us going and make a deal. So let's keep you in our prayers and her as well. Who else are we praying for? Anybody else? Yes.
Just a little addition to what you said about Sharon.
Oh, thank you. Oh, hands it out. Good, good. Yes. She is a miracle many times over. She's... Oh. Yes. Oh, that's so helpful. Thank you, Laureen. That's a helpful word. Yes. That's great. Oh, yes. Congratulations. Oh, all right. Yes. Wow, yes. Right. Let's hold our military and those in harm's way. And Avis, you've been in our prayers as they're trying to figure you out. And, you know, I know that your husband's been working on that for a while longer. Yeah. Oh, dear. I couldn't help but as... Oh, yes. Go ahead. Oh.
Back up here
That's right. So let's continue to remember your family in the midst of this, and an adrenal surgery that's coming up here right away so that that can be normalized and they can, yes.
There were four brothers. And the first three are now gone, and the one that had the liver cancer,
the kidney.
He's doing great.
Yes.
And he's the youngest of four.
Let's continue to keep him in our prayers. Let's remember Jerry. That's right. Other prayers that we have. Yes. Absolutely. Let's. Oh yes, that's right. And as we see this first responder kind of reality, we pray for them. And he's in a very tough environment in Grand Rapids, and we need to pray for the people who are praying and supporting those too, like yourself, because it requires a support system for folks that are facing hard things. So let's keep him in our prayers. Yes. Judy. Great miracle, sure. Yes. Oh, great. Great. I'm glad for Lori and her family and for a travel moment. It's been a tough run for her, so it's good that this is a little break. Spring break gives all new meaning to spring break when you think of that. Thanks for sharing that. You know, as we are singing this last hymn, I was pausing. I've always paused on verse number 2. How sweet it is to hold a newborn baby, you know? You know, doesn't that verse just hit you? Well, this morning as I held a newborn baby, it hit me really hard. What baby do you suppose that is? Huh? Newborn baby. Yes. See, I got you earlier because I got you to sign up, I hope. And everybody that signs up gets a first view of the baby, of course. So we'll pass it around a second time. But little Reed was born late Friday night. And he's a cute little guy with 7 pounds, something, whatever, 21 inches. That's pretty good for a guy, you know, to remember that much, right? And, oh gosh, I'll tell you, Tim and Wendy are absolutely thrilled. They say they've already fallen in love with him. They're going to keep him. That was their first words. And you know, it's kind of an extra way we get to connect with this family because as they have their own church, we're also privileged that, in a sense, we're also a part of their church family and she a part of ours. So we'll find ways for the congregation down the road, a ways for us to not only reach out and support, but also to get a chance to for you to say hello and congratulations. So be kind of watching for that opportunity. We'll do something later on so that they can have time as a family right now. But what a super thing right now. So let's keep them in our prayers. Any other prayers that we have? Yes. All right, Wayne's sons, Chris and Craig, both dealing with medical things, a hernia, and also some testing that's been going on over the last couple of weeks. So let's keep them in our prayers. And let's join together in our prayer song as we prepare for some little bit of prayer. Open our eyes, Lord. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch Him, and say that we love Him. Open our ears, Lord, and help us to listen. Open our eyes, Lord, we want to see Jesus. Precious Lord, you have heard so many of our thoughts and prayers, our joys, our concerns. Lord, we recognize that as we bring them to you here in this place, there is nothing we can share that you don't already know. But Lord, help us as we share together as a congregation and we pray together as a congregation. Lord, hear these prayers. Know of all our joys, know of all our concerns. And help us to live into the world, away from this place, in such a way as to speak of our faith in you. Help us to share the good news of your gospel with a world who has yet to hear. Lord, as your word is read today, and as your word is proclaimed, we pray that it will somehow make a difference in our lives. Hear these prayers. Amen.
Our second hymn today is one that is a gift to us from our youth. They really, I understand they picked it up when the band was here, in a praise time that they had. And they would really like to share this song with us, and it will become a meaningful communion song for our congregation. So would you rise and watch the screen for the words, and look at what the message is in this song, please.
My God would welcome me into this mystery. Take this bread, take this wine, now the sample made divine for any to receive. By your mercy we come to your table. By
Our reading this morning comes to us from the Gospel of John. It's a reading which is very familiar to many of us. It's the death of Lazarus. And it comes to us from chapter 11. Hear these words. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and his sister Martha. Mary was one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill, so the sisters sent a message to Jesus. Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, the illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. And the disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going? And Jesus answered, Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble because they see the light of this world, but those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them. After saying this, he told the disciples, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he's fallen asleep, he'll be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring to just to merely sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad that I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him." Thomas, who is called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us go that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. While Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, while Mary stayed at the home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "Oh, I know that. He will rise again in the resurrection in the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one come into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here, and he's calling for you." And when she heard this, she got up and quickly went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house consoling her saw Mary get up quickly and go out, and they followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in the spirit, and he was deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said to him, "Lord, come and see." And Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it, and Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, you remember the first sister, said to him, "Lord, already there is stench because he's been there dead for 4 days." And Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upwards and he said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth and his face wrapped in cloth. And Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." This, my friends, is God's word for we who are the children of God. Praise be to God. I read a while ago about a pastor who would occasionally go on spiritual retreat, often away to pray, to seek God's direction. During one retreat, someone called the church office and asked, "May I speak with the pastor?" And the secretary replied, "I'm sorry, but he's gone to be with the Lord." There was a long silence on the other end of the line, and then the secretary had realized what she'd said, and she attempted to recover by saying, "But he'll be back next week." I come here today to claim the hope that the gospel gives us, even in moments of great stress, fear, frustration, great loss. I'm sure we're all familiar with the saying, where there's life, there's hope. You know it, don't you? Behind this expression is the assumption that as long as there's life, there is reason to hope. But we know once death comes, all hope is lost. Right? Well, the good news, at least introduced by our text this morning and made ultimately clear in the Easter miracle in the days ahead, is that this saying is wrong. For due to our Lord's victory over death, we can amazingly say, even where there is death, there is hope. Now, the context you've heard, it's a long reading, and I appreciate your willingness to sit and just take it in. Not read it, but take it in today. If we looked at the larger context, we'd realize that Jesus is on his way someplace. And it's not just this place, but he's on his way to Jerusalem, ultimately, where there'll be another death. And so I like to refer to this as the prelude to something else. You see, this idea of where there is death, there is hope, this is at the core of our Christian faith. Even though I die, yet shall I live, and because I live, Jesus says, you shall live also. Our text for the day addresses the Christian's hope, even in the face of the worst that life can send our way. For there's great hope. I believe there's great comfort to be found in the 11th chapter of the Gospel of John. This is a story that unfolds in such an amazing way, in such a brilliant fashion, because we kind of get a warm-up for what's really coming. This is Act 1 of a mighty drama that's there before us. And as this story unfolds, Lazarus becomes seriously ill. The two sisters, Martha and Mary, they've sent word of the condition of their brother to Jesus, expecting that the master will drop everything and he'll rush to his friend's bedside, heal his illness, and thereby snatching him from the very jaws of death. But it's puzzling. In many ways, as we read this, Jesus doesn't respond in the way they expect, and Lazarus dies. The two sisters are perplexed, as are those who have come to mourn with them. Death is the ultimate enemy. How we deal with it determines not simply how we die, but even more importantly, how we live. Max Lucado once wrote, "The grave unearths our views of God." That's really profound. How often do we deal with God in a similar way? You know, the way that Mary and Martha did, demanding to know why God doesn't show up and do something the way that we want it done. and when we want it done. When Martha finds Jesus, the first thing that she says to him is, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. Some take her next words to be an expression of her faith in our Lord's ability to raise Lazarus from the dead. Remember how it goes? But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will grant. Verse 22. I think that she does convey her faith in Jesus by these words, but not to the degree that we might hope or want. I don't think that she's suggesting that if he were to ask God, God would raise Lazarus from the dead then and there. We can tell this by the context and what else is said. When Jesus speaks to Martha about Lazarus' resurrection, she takes this as a reference to his resurrection in the last days, a belief of the Jews of that time that they believed at the end of time all would be raised. She assures Jesus that she believes that he will rise someday. A further clue is found later when Jesus instructs those standing by the tomb to roll away the stone, and it is Martha, that first sister, who objects because he's been in there so long. She doesn't think it's a good idea to roll that stone away. One of the beautiful aspects of Martha's faith is that even though Jesus has caused her disappointment, confusion, and grief, she still clearly believes in him, though like others, she doesn't understand his full identity nor his full power yet. She still trusts him. Jesus assures Martha that Lazarus will come back to life, but she sees this as taking place in the great by and by. I wonder sometimes if Martha isn't a lot like us. We believe in God's power, perhaps hypothetically, maybe ultimately, and that God promises us that things will be okay in the distant future. But often we doubt God's power in the present moment. Jesus now takes Martha to the bedrock of her faith. He declares to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me will never die. Do you believe in this? And she says, I have believed that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who came into the world. Hearing Martha speak puts these words to a place that reminds me of Peter. Remember how he made that claim? He was able to identify Jesus as the Messiah, but in the very next minute you can see that he doesn't really understand what the Messiah is all about. So Martha returns home to summons her sister Mary. When Mary learns that Jesus has arrived and is asking for her, she immediately gets up and rushes out to him. Following along are the mourners who think that she's going to the grave. When Mary arrives at the place outside Bethany where Jesus is, she falls at his feet. And she repeats the same words that Jesus had heard before. Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. From what we read in verse 33, we realize that Mary's words to Jesus are interspersed with deep sobbing, crying. I'm not sure the depth of that heartache is really captured always here in these words. I think maybe they carry the theme where there's life, there's hope. But now all hope is lost. It all seems so senseless to Mary because she knows Lazarus' death could have been prevented. Why did he wait so long to come? Well, Jesus told us this right at the beginning of our reading for today. Jesus knew that the death of Lazarus would not be the final word of this story. We might therefore conclude that all of this grieving is, in one sense, needless. seeing Mary's tears and those of the Jews who came to mourn with her, Jesus is greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He doesn't simply dab away a little tear that may be running or two. His tears are profound. There's something about this situation that really affects him. This is observed by those who are there at the burial place of Lazarus along with Mary, and they say to each other, "Look how much he loved him." Within this scene, we find another expression of bewilderment that Lazarus should have died at all, as we hear the people kind of talking to each other. "This is the one who caused the blind man to see. Couldn't he have done something to keep Lazarus from dying?" There's that theme again, a third time. Wrong, wrong, wrong. Yes, he loved him. But his tears aren't for the loss of a friend. His tears arise as he sees the lack of understanding and misplaced faith in those around him. Jesus arrives to people who see him as strong enough to face the fair fight of illness. But no one expects that Jesus has the power to exceed those limits. It's no longer a fair fight. It's over. Jesus is simply too late. Fair fight. Maybe it's kind of like when you were a kid. When I was a kid and I was out on the playground, you might hear those words echoing across the playground, "Fight! Fight!" And you'd look around to see where it was happening. And then you'd gravitate to that place as two angry children faced off with each other, fists in the air. Everybody would kind of gather around to watch. Looking back, I'm a little bit ashamed to admit the attraction. You wanted to see who would win. That morbid curiosity that would draw a crowd to watch a fight. But when I see Jesus entering into the graveyard that day in this story, to the cave that holds the body of his friend, Lazarus, I see him moving into the home field of his supreme enemy, death. And I want to yell, "Fight! Fight!" What will Jesus say? What will Jesus do? Yes, his flaring emotions in that moment connect directly with the lack of understanding of the people around. They simply didn't get it. They simply didn't get him. They didn't understand who Jesus really was, who he really was. Many claims have been made in this gospel alone concerning the person of who Jesus is. John, the gospel writer, tells us that Jesus is God and that he was present and active from the beginning of the world. A little later, John the Baptist declares that Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Jesus himself claims to have come from God, that he'll return to God. He is the means by which people can be born again to obtain eternal life. We move on to chapter 4. He very clearly identifies himself for the first time to the woman at the well, that he is the Messiah. Chapter 6, after feeding 5,000, Jesus declares that he is the bread of life. It's come down from heaven, giving eternal life, he says. Chapter 6, those who eat this bread of life, he says, we'll never die. Both chapters 5 and chapter 6, Jesus claims to have the authority to raise the dead. In John 8, Jesus tells the Jews that if anyone keeps his word, he will never see death. In verse 58 of chapter 8, he declares himself to be I am, who exists before Abraham. And in chapter 10, Jesus insists that he gives his sheep eternal life, which no one can take away. He says that he has the power to lay down his life as well as the power to take it up again. My friends, these are bold claims. And the veracity of these declarations of our Lord are demonstrated by the raising of Lazarus from the dead. You see, Jesus deliberately delays coming to Lazarus until after all hope of saving his life has long gone. The tradition in the Jewish among the Jewish people to wait a few days, 4 days was way long enough. They knew he was gone. He's not just dead, he's good and dead. And it's not until this point that Jesus comes to Bethany, where he will bring new life. But the ultimate sign is yet to come. It sits just on the horizon. As I speak to you this morning, it's a few weeks off from today. It's the preeminent sign that Jesus is life. It is our Lord's own resurrection. The raising of Lazarus is indeed but a prelude to the great final sign of our Lord. John is correct when he writes in the fourth verse of this gospel, "In him was life." The words of one who can raise the dead are those to which we should give careful attention. We've all heard it said, "Where there is hope." But I'm here today to tell you, in the light of our story of Lazarus, and more centrally in light of the resurrection of Jesus himself, we Christians can say far more than that. For the gospel of Jesus Christ invites us to a new claim: where there is death, there is hope. In fact, where there is death, Jesus brings life. Many people look at themselves as Martha and Mary viewed Lazarus. They see him as sick and in need of help, and they believe Jesus might be able to heal a sick person, but they don't believe he can raise a dead man. When we're without Christ, we're not merely sick, we are dead. In need of the life which Jesus can bring. I'm saying that it really wasn't necessary for Lazarus to die here so that true biblical faith could be produced in many. It was necessary for all hope of Lazarus' human recovery to die with him so that the resurrection power of our Lord could be undeniably demonstrated. Where there is life, there's hope. No. In the name of Jesus Christ, even where there is death, there is hope. Praise be to God. I'd like to invite our ushers to come forward to take today's offering. Please stand. Lord, use our voices, use our hands, Lord, use our lives, they are yours, we are an offering. Lord, use our voices, they are yours, we are an offering. All that we are, all that we hope to be, we give to you, we give to you. Use our voices, we lift our hands, we lift our we are an offering. We are an offering. Lord, receive these offerings of ourselves. May they be a symbol of all that we are held up to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. The night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. He gave it to the disciples and he said, "Take, drink from this, all of you, for this is the cup of the new covenant, the blood which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Almighty God, send the power of your Holy Spirit on us gathered here out of love for you, and help us to know in the breaking of this bread and the drinking of this wine your powerful presence here among us this day. In your name we pray. Amen. Friends, in our church, all are welcome. Anybody that's here in this room is welcome to come and receive. Some of you have not been here since we began celebrating in a little bit different way. People will be invited to come down the aisle. When you individually are ready, you can come and gather here around a table. Pray as long as you would like. When you're ready to receive, simply take one of the wafers, take a cup, receive when you're ready. When you're done, your cup can go into the bowl that's down below, and then you can return by the side aisle. There are two kinds of bread at each station, little discs of whole wheat, and then the gluten-free on the other side, and they're marked, so you can use either you'd like. We're trying to create a place where you can carve out your own time. When you come, this is your place. When you leave, someone else from the aisle will step in, so be watching for places that you can step in and fill those spaces. Tables are ready. There's a small table on the end for people that would like something lower and for families might want to gather around that space. But come. This is a time for you to receive the body and blood of Christ. Amen. Come, everything is ready. I will deliver communion out into the congregation. If you'd like to receive, simply raise your hand and I'll come to you. The body and blood of Christ broken for you.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken.
If you'd like to receive in the pew, simply raise your hand. Are there others who would receive in their pew today? Free to fill in around the tables as there's empty space. Body and blood of Christ broken and shed.
Father, we lay our crown at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of mercy and love at the feet of Jesus.
Beneath
the cross of Jesus I fain would take my stand. The shadow of a mighty rock within a weary land, the home within the wilderness, rest upon the way. From the burning of the noontide heat and the burden of the day, I take, O cross, thy shadow for my abiding place. I see no other sunshine than the sunshine of his face. Content to let the world go by, no, no gain nor loss. My humble self, my only shame and glory of the cross. And now let us go from this place in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.